So these lenses were tested. Two copies of the Voigtlander 180 apochromatic, two copies of the Voigtlander 125 apochromatic versus the Zeiss 85 planar. The test is not complete though. First of all, I didn't have time. Number two, the weather was bad. The only day where the weather was good was the day that you see right now on your screens, which is everything had turned into a small lake or patches. You could not walk anywhere in the woods or in a park without being filled with mud. And I also decided to include in this test the Zeiss 135 and the Nikon 135 AIS, the old one, the 2.8. Now, this is the Voigtlander 125 at 2.5, which is, it's more open aperture, it's wider aperture. And one of the things that immediately caught my attention was the point spread function of this lens, which is absolutely minimal or non-existent. The point spread function is the disfigurement of the speculars, especially in the autofocus areas. And I see here, for example, this point here, this point here, this point here. It has very, very low point spread function. Look at this little bitty, these little dots here, all the way up to the edge of the frame at the widest aperture. And let me show you what I mean by that. Of course, it's also, the lens is also apochromatic to a great extent, but let me show what I mean. This is the Zeiss 85 planar. And I was surprised actually that from a specific angle, such as this one, I got almost zero chromatic aberrations at 1.4, which is the widest aperture of this lens. You can see, of course, some coloration here at the speculars, but look at this. You see this? How it is deformed and has a specific direction, so to speak. It's taken a different shape. And this is something that one can see. Look at this here. Now, in this case, of course, these are very, very small. These are tiny in the image. They're not going to be noticed by anybody. But if you have, let's say, a Christmas tree or city lights at night, and you use wide open, look at this. See? You'll get this point spread function, as it's called. The Voigtlander is completely free of all that. But maybe it's not fair to judge them at 1.4, because the Voigtlander goes starts from 2.5. This is 1.8 with the Zeiss, and this is 2.8 with the Zeiss. So you see there is some coloration here, some greenish stuff in the speculars. And the speculars are still a little bit, you know, like dropping droplets or something, or like traveling droplets. But these are not, I mean, in images like that, it's not an issue at all. That's why I want to test the lenses further. So far I'm thrilled with the 125, especially the quality of the bokeh. I mean, the lens is a bokeh monster. Too bad it is 125 and not something more usable, like a 50 or a 70 or something, or 85. So take a look at this. This is a 2.5, and it's almost completely out of free of colorations. And this too, and it kind of has I think I focused here or somewhere here. I was not with the tripod here. It's some kind of like an impressionistic bokeh. This is what thrilled me the most, that it doesn't really disform the objects that are in the distance, but renders them really nicely. Other lenses kind of like create a big blur in those instances. This is a macro lens, the 125. and at its macro function, it is absolutely, the bokeh is absolutely spectacular. I'm going to show you, my daughter used it as macro actually. She liked the lens. She put it on the D500 and she took a couple, she started taking whatever little flowers the deer had left. Now here, maybe I see just a tiny bit of violet fringing, but it's not really concerning. If you expose to the right, you'll get more of it, but this is, it is not deformed. And this is a 2.5. Their 58 lens, the Voigtlander 58, would have completely obliterated these little branches. Completely obliterate them. They would not even be visible as branches from this distance. And if you underexpose a little bit, you get rid of it, apparently. This is a f4, I think, and in this instance here I was focusing here in this area as better as I could, and I took several shots here, stayed a little bit to relax and took several shots at different speeds and aperture values, and everything seems to be pretty much perfect. So in this image here, this area is overblown because it's lit directly by the sun. You see how overblown it is, and it is at I think it is at f 2.5, and there is no color or fringing or aberrations of any kind that I can see. You gotta check your angle of shooting, of course, but this was an example. I mean, the planar here or any other uncorrected lens would have rendered the entire area here like purple or something like that. And this was a surprising performance. It is at f4 where it clears up a little bit. Maybe I was a little out of focus, but the performance is really spectacular. So then my daughter got the lens. Now a little break here. This is with the Voigtlander 180 APO. So she got the lens, she put it on the D500. These are all manual focused handheld, and I did not hit them all. I do not know why people say that this lens is not sharp at f4, which is the widest aperture, the 180, because this is, you know, focused on the fly, as we say. You know, you just raise the camera and focus. Now I did miss, did I miss this one? No, this one is fine. I did miss this one. She moved a little further away. I hit the tree though. The tree is just fine. And this is at f4. So one has to be careful with this lens, the 180. But my daughter got the 125 on the D500 to take some macro flowers and stuff, whatever flowers the deer had left. That was the first time she was using a macro lens and the first time she was using a manual lens. Keep that in mind. And the Voigtlander 125 has an insanely big throw. Insane. I mean, it goes, and you turn it, I don't know, like three or four times its barrel. It's ridiculous. So she missed the first, and she did not have a tripod. And she did not have a stool or a chair or somewhere to sit. And she was kneeling down, and look at this picture. That's fine. She missed it here. But even in the ones that where she missed it, the bokeh is unbelievable. This is a 2.5. The bokeh is unbelievable. I think it is actually better. I don't know why she took this, and I don't even know what this is. I think that the bokeh is better than the Zeiss 100, the planar. It has some rapid transitions, though, you see, the in-focus from out-of-focus areas. Rapid transitions. Here she missed it. Here she kind of got it. I should have told her that when she's so close, she should not be using f4. And here she missed it, but look at the bokeh again. It's totally like a painting. missed it, got it. This is a picture where it actually kind of stunned me. Not because she got the focus right. The focus is in. It's not here, it's on the pedals. All right, no problem. It is the quality of the bokeh again, because the Zeiss Planar 100 had kind of like patchy transitions between the black and green areas. So this will be more like a black patch or a dark patch. This is more like a green patch. And this renders it smoothly. The entire area is completely smooth. So as far as macro is concerned, this is a far better lens than the 100 Planar Zeiss. The dimensional rendering is also off the charts, and I decided to print this, to print it in a crop like here. So I'm going to leave it a couple of seconds on the screen just for you to check it out. At any rate, given my workload, there is no way for me to put an entire day aside or 2 days to do a thorough test, but I decided at least to test these lenses part by part and then upload a complete video in several terms of their performance. The smallest section will be sharpness. All these lenses are sharp. The biggest one will be probably the rendering style and the bokeh. I will also include the Nikon 135. Why? Because I like the underdog lenses, and this is a very cheap lens and the smallest of the bunch. So it will take me a few days. Thanks a lot. Bye. Thank you.